Okay, I'll do the, let me do the intro, right? And then we'll get started. Hello everyone, this is Dwight Woods, the Jeet Kune Do Rebel, 5 minutes early, 6 minutes early. Welcome to today's show, episode number 131 of the Jeet Kune Do Dialogues. As you're logging in, if you'd be kind enough to say where you're logging in from, hit the like button and feel free to continue doing so throughout the dialogue. Also, if you're catching the final edit replay over on the YouTube, please hit the like button, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. If you enjoy my work and want to support the program, consider making a purchase over at jkdrebel.com/store. But of course, the best thing you can do is to spread the word and talk about the Jeet Kune Do Dialogues, which really is the way that Mr. Nyman and I came across each other, because we are famous Facebook friends. Right. And that's how I saw some stuff of his, and I thought, this is a guy with whom I could have an interesting conversation. So with that, hey, is it pronounced Jari or Yari?
Yari.
Yari.
But I'm kind of used to any kind of
Well, in any case, Jari Nyman, welcome to the Jeet Kune Do Dialogues.
Thank you. My pleasure.
So what is that? Where are you behind you? Are you in your school? Is that your home? Is that an office of some
office.
Type?
The office, yeah.
Okay. But because what I was trying to determine is you don't have a school, but you do run a group, right?
Yeah, I have a group. It's a private group.
Right.
But it's we used to be in a school, but now because of the change of private school laws, so we needed to go to a gym.
Okay, so well, it's probably better. What do you prefer? Do you prefer having a private group or having a school?
I have a private school, a private group.
Yeah. Is. Because I always wonder about whether there are differences between, in the Jeet Kune Do experience, between different parts of the world. Now, you've been to the you come to the U.S. over and over again. So can you tell me a little bit about your observation in just that area of, when it comes to teaching Jeet Kune Do, if you've seen any differences between how it's done in the US and how it's done in Europe?
Yeah, maybe in Europe, because we are so far away, people tend to appreciate more the teaching. And in US, even you have a chance to study with the original students of Bruce Lee, you kind of think that that's something that, well, if I don't go this week, I go next week, or it's so close that you don't really appreciate that. But when you come from Europe, it's kind of once in a lifetime opportunity. So you make use of the every second you are training at.
Right. Yeah. Now it's interesting to me that you mentioned the opportunity to train with even an original Bruce Lee student, because the second that I started doing my research on you, one thing that, and correct me if I'm wrong, one thing that jumped out to me is that it was important to you to get to original sources when it comes to Jeet Kune Do. Am I right?
No. I was searching always for not only the original students, but really the key pieces of the puzzle, so that I would understand what was Bruce Lee thinking in his head, and trying to understand what he was trying to say when he was writing certain sentences in a Tao or whatever. So it was not just only physical training, but also the understanding the art.
Okay, I'm going to jump ahead to a question that actually in my notes, I have it later, but I'm going to jump ahead now. Jeet Kune Do, an art, a philosophy, or both?
Yeah, I've been reading this in
the- You recognize that, right?
Yeah. I think JKD is really well defined when they say JKD is philosophy in action. So that is what I feel, and that's the way I feel the philosophy behind the words is to apply in a physical movement. So you understand the philosophy through movement, not that it's two separate things. It's one thing that is the yin and yang. The art can be physical or it can be philosophical, but philosophy and the physical art makes one.
Okay. All right. I like how you just pronounced philosophical. So how many languages do you speak?
On a daily basis, just three.
On a daily basis, just three, yeah. Right? Yeah. Okay, tell everybody why that is.
Well, I'm originally from Finland. I live in Spain. And then I have a lot of international friends, so I speak English. So that's about it.
Yeah, well, see, here in America, we struggle with just English, man.
Yeah. Well, my grandfather's mother tongue was Swedish, and then that's also obligatory in Finnish schools. But fortunately, I jumped that, so I don't need to speak Swedish. So.
Okay. So how did you end up in Spain then?
My parents moved here 35 years ago, June. So it's quite a long time ago. And they asked my brother and me if we want to move. And I said, no, never. And I'm still here. So it's not a bad place to stay.
What's your favorite thing about Spain after 30 something years?
Favorite? There's loads of favorites. There's only good things out here. So.
Oh, I see.
Even Ted Wong said that the best seafood in the world is here in Spain. So that's why he came back once. Again. So, yeah.
How many times did he come over there?
No idea.
Wow.
Maybe three times a year, two times a year. So, I studied with him 15 years. So a lot of times he came here.
Yeah, and I saw from your Facebook photographs, you made a lot of notes.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, Ted Wong always said that if you don't write notes, you're gonna forget, or you're gonna remember the things in a different way that it was taught on that time. So it's like putting money in a bank. So it's
right. I just want everybody to see what I'm talking about here.
But these are only my notes from the classes I've given. So
these are not even your Ted Wong seminar notes.
No, those are not seminar notes. Those are only the classes that. Well, there's one page which is open, which is from the seminar with Ted Wong. Yeah, but all the others, yeah.
You're gonna run out of room pretty soon.
Yeah, well, it's good to have though.
Yeah, you're gonna have to get a storage unit or something.
Yeah, well, with all the books and the notes, it's space that you think that maybe there's no better way to use it, but also it takes a lot of dust and stuff like that. So you need to be using that. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So listen, let's get this out of the way so that our mutual good friend Bob Landers doesn't complain. Okay, is that the Tom Cruise picture?
No, the Tom Cruise history is long way. That's from the late 90s. Yeah, that's from LA. Yeah, that's different story. That's different story.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, can you tell us the Tom Cruise story?
Maybe not totally, but there's this, some parts that I can tell. One lady that thought that we had some similarities with Tom Cruise and me. That was the Tom Cruise of JKD.
Oh, so Bob Landers is just jealous because nobody ever thought he looked like Tom Cruise, huh?
Yeah, maybe he has.
Okay, so your first, let's do this. Any martial arts before Jeet Kune Do?
Yeah, I did kickboxing until second dan.
Okay.
And competed a little bit and all that. So I then went into the JKD Concepts line, which kind of got me hooked into all this JKD Brotherhood kind of thing. So
right.
I think that was those were the golden era of JKD on that time in the early 90s.
How old were you when you did the kickboxing? From what age to what age?
I was like 16, 17 till 1915 till 19 or something like that.
Okay. All right. So then what spearheaded the Jeet Kune Do, the interest in Jeet Kune Do? Where did that come from? How did that come about?
Yeah, well, I had an extremely motivational teacher in the school, Mark Woolley. Best regards to him. So in the every recess, he was doing the JKD Concepts on that time, and in every recess, he said, you come and let's do this, and he was choking me and doing all these kind of things from the Silat and from Kali and from different things, and I thought, wow, that's amazing. And he said, you come around and you try. And then I went for a tryout, and here I am.
Yeah. And when was your first trip to the US?
In 97.
So that was about 4 years later or so then?
I started in JKD 91.
Okay.
Yeah, but I did the seminars here in Spain before that.
Okay. All right. And you said, so your start was in what people would call the JKD Concepts.
Mm.
And so you spent about 6 years in that. So then your quest then, did your interest change and then you went off in another direction?
Yeah.
How would you explain it?
Yeah, well, I came from kickboxing. So I was actually, first I got really interested in Muay Thai. And then from Muay Thai to Kali and Escrima, and Richard Bustillo wanted me to go to Philippines for the World Championships and all that, but my parents didn't let me on that time. And and then JKD didn't play too much of my interest on that time until I met Ted Wong for the first time in 95. And then I thought, well, this is what I want to learn.
Right. Yeah. And that was at one of the Nucleus meetings or something?
No, it was here in Spain. Seminar here in Spain.
Okay. So that's how you got into. I hate the fact that we sometimes have to use the terms Jeet Kune Do Concepts and original Jeet Kune Do, you know, because it just, for people who are hearing it, they'll think, oh, well, so he's from a different camp and he's from a different camp. But you and I agree that it's an art and a philosophy. So where is the so-called different camp? This is a stupid question, but I'm going to ask it. Okay. What did you love most about Ted Wong? I know it's a stupid question.
No, I don't think it's a stupid question. I think a lot of people didn't know him. I think his integrity, is integrity. When you talk about anything, you talk JKD or Bruce Lee, life in general, talking with kids, teaching art, eating in a restaurant. It's just his way of being was honestly expressing himself with the integrity.
Yeah, that's why actually, if you notice, I put the picture of you and him in the center of the postcard, where it talks about commitment. You know, because again, there was something I sensed about that. I go, okay, this should be the centerpiece, because if Ted Wong was anything, he was committed to Jeet Kune Do, right?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. It was his way of kind of paying back the luck that he had met Bruce Lee, and he was able to kind of change his life thanks to Bruce Lee.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So I still want you to if you can remember to break down the order in which, so because we have the pictures of you with Alan Joe, we have the pictures with Jesse Glover, and then of course we have the pictures with Ted Wong. So you don't have to do them in chronological order, but just tell me how those events came about. What drove you to meet with these people? Did you train with them? Did you just talk with them and stuff like that?
Like I said in the beginning, that I was interested to know the way of thinking of Bruce Lee. Mm-hmm. And obviously Ted Wong was for me the ultimate, the physical, even the way of being, I think, of like Bruce Lee.
Yeah.
But obviously, Bruce Lee had different students in different eras. And after seeing them and training with them, you can see that either they were special before meeting Bruce Lee, and that's why Bruce Lee took them as his students, or mm-hmm. Bruce Lee made them special. But I think they were special because that mm-hmm. lasted until the last days of their lives. Everyone I've met has been extremely special and extremely, I think, extremely motivational as well. And if you take any martial art, I think in JKD you have this kind of fortune to have, at least me in my case, to have trained with these people, to really sense the art and the experience that they have had of Bruce Lee. And like Richard Bustillo, he didn't have any pictures with Bruce Lee. He didn't train that much with Bruce Lee. But like he said, he always said that even one session with Bruce Lee just changed the life of the person, because he was so charismatic. And in the same way, I think to sense that energy through different students of his, I think that for me that was very important to feel that, and to feel that energy that each person could pass on. Like good example is Taki, that I think the best picture of him is with two umbrellas in the gravesite of Bruce Lee, one for Bruce and one for him. I think just the examples like that. Or Alan Joe, when he was 90s plus years old, he was still punching the bag and all that and doing the stuff because of Bruce Lee. People lived decades after Bruce Lee passed away, even though they had just met Bruce Lee for months or for years, and they did everyday things to remember Bruce Lee. I think that's incredible. And I think that is something that I wanted to feel. I wanted to grasp that.
And you got it? You felt it?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt, but the difficult thing in my case, I think, is to try to pass that on, that energy, so that the students can feel that. And because personally, I don't feel a fan of Bruce Lee, and I started training JKD without knowing who Bruce Lee was.
Right.
So I have learned of Bruce Lee thanks to JKD and his students and his family members. So it's been kind of other way around that usually it is. So I have learned from him, I think, in a different way. That is something that I want to pass on.
Do you think it's possible to build a passion for Jeet Kune Do in the student?
Absolutely. I think that is the main purpose of instruction, is to create passion. Because if you don't have passion, life is ups and downs. And when you are down, you need this happy thought, like Peter Pan, or this that makes you fly, so you know when the uphill comes, so you know how to go up, because you have this happy thought. You need to have this star that keeps you going, because if you are down, you know that the star is behind the hill. So if you climb the hill up, you know that the star is there. So the students need to learn this, that there is break up with a girlfriend, there's a money problem, there's this, there's that, which affects on your motivation in your training. So when you go and train, that is your happy place, which gives you the motivation. And I always want to tell my students from the movie 300, there's this quote that says that the strength of Sparta is the warrior next to you. That means the warrior next to you gives you the motivation, because he tries to do the best so you won't do less. And if you do the most, you can also, the warrior next to you will do the most. So it's right. Pushes each other to be motivated. So when you come to a training, even though when you are home and you're sitting in your sofa and say, raining or whatever, you feel bad, but you know that you go to a training and you know that that's always worth it. And you create this kind of passion to go to a
training. Yeah. Is part of creating passion in the students being passionate as an instructor?
I think there's extremely close relationship with teacher, instructor, and the student. I think you never have a bad student and a good instructor, or a bad instructor and a good student. I think they are very closely connected. And also in a spiritual way, not only technical, but also in a technical way, because the instructor can investigate more things when the students are of higher level.
Right.
If they are motivated, they push the instructor to work harder. And when the instructor is motivated, he pushes the students to work harder. So it's kind of 1 + 1 = 3 equation.
Which is more than yin yang then.
So it's the symbols around it. Yeah.
Right, yeah, I love that. Let me ask you this. Do you think that you would have developed a philosophical mind without Jeet Kune Do?
No.
If you'd stayed in kickboxing.
Absolutely not. No. I think that is really the greatness of JKD is that it has a really deep philosophy, but it's so deeply and so closely connected to the physical part that it's not a separate thing.
Right. Is that what makes Jeet Kune Do different?
Yes.
Because there are people who think, oh, it's another martial art.
No.
Yeah.
I think you can't have philosophy, understand the philosophy, and you can't have the physical art and understand the physical art if you don't have the two.
Right.
You need both.
Have you ever had to explain that to students and ask them, for example, what's the philosophy of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu?
In one time of our training, we had like once in a month, we went to visit different schools of different arts, Kenpo, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, Muay Thai, kickboxing, or different arts. Or the instructor, or Krav Maga, they came to give us a lesson. And I think always after the class, on the next class, we talked about that. And I think it was always interesting to analyze the differences or the similarities of different arts. And it always comes to in my opinion, into the fact that JKD is very physical. It is extremely physical, but it's also intellectual. So it's not only for mass art. It is for people that are willing to train physically hard, but also think. It's not that you come to a class, you do your series of punching and kicking, and then you go home. It's more than that. And I want, in my case of my students, I want them to understand that it is not that I give them the technique, they learn it and that's it, but they need to understand it.
So the thinking in Jeet Kune Do is important, but also the thinking about Jeet Kune Do is important.
When we talk about JKD, I think one thing that we need to remember is that it's simple, direct, and effective. Or you always say non-classical and all that, that's like Bruce Lee wrote that. But effective means that if there is a easier way, the faster way, shorter way, you might as well try to learn that. And I think that's something what you learn in JKD can be used elsewhere in the life, which is about JKD being a lifestyle. It's very like typical to say martial arts is a way of life and this and that. And like it's always said, but to understand it really, that it's simple, direct, and effective to express yourself honestly, like Bruce Lee said, that, my friend, is very hard to do. Because society nowadays makes us to think always these different complicated things. So simplify things, that's difficult.
Okay. All right, let me get your take then, since we're talking about commonly used Jeet Kune Do expressions. Let me get your take on some of them. So here's one. Jeet Kune Do, a process, not a product. What's your take on that?
Oh yeah, it's a journey. Yeah, it's searching for the horizon, which never you never get there. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. I think that's the really the amazing thing about JKD is that you are always mastering, but you never become a master.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
So does that make it different then to let's pick on Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu again? Because for a lot of people, the goal in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is the black belt. Mm. So that kind of makes it a product, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe I'm like what you call yourself. I'm a little rebel. I'm the black belt, so I don't believe in any of that kind of thing. So
right.
So I don't certify my students. That's another issue that because I'm not certified by Ted Wong either.
Mm-hmm.
So but that doesn't mean that what he has taught me I would not know, because right. That's my responsibility, and he knew what I knew.
Right.
And before his passing away, it was clear that where I were. But, mm-hmm. but obviously things changed since then. But that was Bruce Lee as well. After 68, he didn't certify anyone in any of his styles. Right. So it was he stopped believing in certificates. So I think the motivation needs to come from somewhere else. And because I don't have a commercial school, so I don't need to think about that. So yeah. Obviously, if you have a commercial school, you need to find the motivation elsewhere. But in my case, I don't have need for that.
Yeah. On that whole idea of style, in reading on your website, if I have it correctly, you say it didn't start out as a style, but it is kind of a style.
It is a style.
Okay.
It is a style. JKD is a style, obviously, with a certain structure, certain technique, certain philosophy, certain physical parts of it.
Yeah.
Without those, if you don't have the roots of JKD, you would not have JKD. And I think that's the confusion that there is in all around the world, because Bruce Lee said that he doesn't believe in styles and all that kind of thing. That doesn't mean that what he meant with style, meaning karate or Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, which is very strict, JKD is much more open, which, mm-hmm. which makes it much more harder to understand, and obviously much more difficult to learn. But still, it is a style, because if you go to a JKD class, you see it's a JKD. It's not karate, or it's not Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, or it's not right. Kempo, or it's not Krav Maga. Why? Because it's a style.
Yeah.
And if you have the roots of JKD, what comes out is always the same. But if you have wrong roots, obviously it's not JKD anymore. So I think there is the confusion that because what I like or whatever, this, I feel better, I get better doing this, because it's my JKD, that's wrong. JKD is a style that needs to be learned, the philosophy and the physical part, but it's a style.
Do you think that is part of the problem in, you know, where some people have the idea, and maybe some people even teach that it's not a style, it's a concept, it's a it's a philosophy. Because, okay, your take on this one, because this is one that I've heard. Junfan is the art or the style, and Jeet Kune Do is the philosophy. Have you heard that one?
A few times, yeah.
a few times too many.
I'm kind of tired of always trying to explain that, but I think that that comes my personal take on that is that that comes from Inosanto when he promised not to teach JKD, and so he thought, let's teach Junfan method or Junfan Kung Fu or whatever you wanted to call it, and then of his personal interest, he wanted to learn different arts, Filipinos and Indonesian and all these kind of different arts. So it was his way of seeing things. And obviously he was by far the most visible person in the Bruce Lee martial art world. So his influence was extremely strong, which even today can be seen that people still read these and all the books and the writings that they that there are, and JKD is said that it's just a philosophy. JKD is the art which comes from Junfan, Kung Fu, and evolves to JKD. The Jeet Kune Do is the final art that Bruce Lee had before he passed away, not Junfan. The three schools, the curriculum was Junfan Kung Fu, which maybe he was referring that people are mistaken the way and all that. So he stopped the schools. Because it requires more attention than just have a class, and he didn't have time to go and teach that much, and maybe it wasn't his interest anymore to have these courses. So.
Right. I wanted to ask you about that because earlier you had, when we were talking for a little bit about certificates, you said that after 68 he didn't certify anybody in his three arts. So I wanted to ask you if you think that there were three different things that were taught, or it's just that he had three types of certificates, or what?
Yeah, that's another confusion, that there were three arts. It was no three arts. No one ever has been able to explain what is Tao of Chinese Kung Fu. Mm-hmm. So that was given just for the actors and all these kind of that. I think they never learned anything, so it was just something to give for the money. Mm-hmm. And the Junfan Kung Fu certificates, those were for of the three academies, and the JKD was of his art for the private students. So it was, I think Ted Wong's certificate of December 67 is the last one of
the last JKD
certificate. But no three arcs.
I posted this, I think it was yesterday, like late last night or something. And now I'm trying to remember what the topic was, but I ended up writing, sometimes I wish that Bruce Lee had never become a celebrity. Hmm. Have you ever felt that way?
Maybe not, because if he would not have been celebrity, I would have not learned JKD.
Okay.
So in a way, it's thanks to him and his achievement that he's become a celebrity, household name, that so many people around the world have been able to have at least some access to the art of JKD or his art that he was creating, that
right.
Otherwise would have been dead. And then, I don't think even in Los Angeles, in the Filipino Academy, I don't think no one would have taught there JKD if Bruce Lee would have been a celebrity, because no one would have searched for him.
Mm-hmm. So it could have remained a backyard thing, and we would never have known about it.
Yeah, maybe not even a backyard thing. I think people like Ted Wong trained. Some of the students trained at the Filipino Academy, like in a private class. But I think, what was their motivation? I think the motivation was also the Bruce Lee charisma that made him to have a footprint on them until the last breath of their lives. So right. I think it was a lucky that he was a celebrity.
Okay. All right. Let's do another trip down fantasy land, and then come back to the Jeet Kune Do Saints. What if Bruce Lee had lived?
Yeah, that's a good question that a lot of people ask, and usually always in the seminars, people ask those from the original Bruce Lee students, and it's interesting to hear the answers from different original Bruce Lee students. But I think most of them agree that he would have become like a monk and gone away from the martial arts world and to seek peace of mind, yeah, instead of being the 30-year-old active martial arts legend that is in the movies. I think if he would be 70 or this year 80, I think I would see him like between Ted Wong and Alan Joe. Ted Wong meaning that he would be able to execute everything that he had taught and learned and practiced. I think he would have been extremely fit.
Mm-hmm.
But also, I think as an Alan Joe kind of person that was more into chi, and I don't mean chi, the spiritual chi, but like way of breathing, way of relaxing, more philosophical person. I think he would have been kind of between these two in his also maybe a kind of Dan Lee kind of difficult to say, but
okay. All right, let's go back to the common sayings. Your take on using no way as way, having no limitation as limitation.
I think there comes the fact of the styles and the JKD as a style.
Yeah.
And in Bruce Lee's way of thinking of the styles on that time of their time when the styles were very rigid, I think if using one way is kind of limitation, and in his case he was kind of breaking all the patterns and searching for new ways that no one was ever done before. So I think he was breaking all the limitations that people had like fixed mind,
right,
which he thought out of the box and thought things that, for example, in his training equipment, he was extremely innovative on that. So he created a new wave of martial arts. I think maybe that would have happened later on, but I think he was before his time in that right. way.
Okay. Jeet Kune Do, it's just a name. Don't fuss over it.
Yeah. There was this time that I went to visit these different JKD schools because they were teaching JKD, or they called it JKD, but it's not JKD. And JKD as a name is extremely commercial. It's easy to open a school and say, I teach my JKD, and someone has certified me, and that's it. I just start teaching. If you go and do any martial art, you need a federation, or you need this certificate, which is certified by this and this person. So there's certain rules, but in JKD, it's just a name, and no one knows what JKD is. So you just put a JKD school, and people search for JKD school, and they come to you, and you teach whatever, and it's okay. So I think that's a serious thing that never gonna be fixed. So it's don't fuss over the name. I think people that has studied JKD really, I think they need to have the respect and teach that on, so that the real art of Jeet Kune Do will survive, because right. it seems that there's always jumps out these non-JKD, JKD schools that has nothing to do with JKD. And if you mm-hmm. search the lineage of the JKD, of these schools, there's no lineage whatsoever. They have just kind of invented or learned from books, so which is totally impossible.
Right. So you would be in favor of some kind of a governing body?
I would, but I know that certainly it would never happen. And certainly, if I would be to choose the people there, then I would go against a lot of people. And opposite way around. So if someone creates the governing body and I'm not in, I won't accept that. So why someone that is outside of this governing body would accept this kind of nucleus that was the original idea a few years back?
Yeah,
that didn't work out. So it would never work out. The truth that every instructor is always higher than what they can receive from some governing body from outside.
Yeah. You touched on it a little bit about people, you know, just announcing that they're teaching Jeet Kune Do, and when they're not really. But within the Jeet Kune Do world, so we're not talking about people who don't know what to look for and they don't know what they're seeing. Within the Jeet Kune Do world, what are some of the major mistakes you think people make in interpreting Jeet Kune Do?
I think the core of JKD is the footwork. Mm-hmm. And maybe that is the hardest thing to keep practicing. and also hardest thing to learn, because there's only, in my opinion, only Ted Wong that knew JKD footwork. So if people don't know the base of JKD, the root, one of the main roots, it's very difficult for them to understand all the rest. So if you don't have the mobility of JKD, your footwork, then it's very difficult to understand why you punch or kick in a certain way and you don't trap or whatever, you don't block, so because of the footwork. But if you don't have the footwork, it's like you don't have the color in your TV, you don't understand how the how nice the flowers are. So it's the same thing. If you don't have the footwork, then you don't understand the beauty of the I always say that you have this kind of a bubble around you and a bubble around the opponent. So these bubbles bump into each other. So in between you have this no man's land, and you either, when you invade the no man's land, you are one step ahead of your opponent because you are obliging him. It's like a chess move. You're obliging him to do a move, but you already know what he's going to do because you are obliging him with your body movement and with the footwork to move in a certain way. So you are one step ahead.
Okay. So now, in the teaching of that footwork to two different age groups, kids and older people.
What do you mean, kids?
Yeah. Are kids able to understand the importance of footwork?
I personally don't teach kids, but I have a student that teaches kids, and I think that is very interesting because obviously kids learn through play, and you can do a lot of kind of different plays and with footwork, and that is something that can be applied to adults as well. I think,
but older people who are not perhaps as fit or as mobile, and they're starting out.
Maybe JKD is not for them. I don't know. If an older people wants to learn JKD, it's a big sacrifice. JKD is not an easy art. And footwork is not easy to learn. And obviously footwork is like skipping rope. If you can't skip rope, it's impossible to skip rope.
Right, yeah. Who is your, besides yourself, because I've seen, like it's like this. When I see somebody out there and there's a JKD label attached to them, with most of the times, I can look at them and I can go, Paul Vunak, or I could go, now I'm able to do it. I look and I go, Ted Wong. And a lot of times it's because of the footwork. So who's, besides yourself, who's your favorite footwork genius out there?
Genius, besides me. This is very promotional, but I think I'm very fortunate to have very good students, and I have extremely good students that are very good in footwork, because that's something that I stress in each training. And I think my top students are very good in footwork. And that's something that Ted Wong on that, on when he was still alive 10 years ago. So 11 years ago when he visited my school last time, he acknowledged these people to be extremely good with their foot.
Nice. So in keeping it simple, direct, and effective, in teaching that, is it a question of doing the same thing over and over and over again? Or, and is it a question of doing the same thing over and over again?
Yes.
Okay.
I think
so then.
Yeah, but to be a little addition on there.
Yeah.
Doing it over and over again, but different opponents. Different.
Ah.
Because always the distance, the reach, the speed, everything changes with the opponent. So it's not same thing doing a combination with
right.
one person than to do with the other person.
Okay. Because in the classical art, it's the same thing over and over again, the same way.
Hmm.
In order to get good at it. And in teaching it, they have a saying in the more traditional art to disguise the repetition.
Mm.
You see? So if they want to teach something, maybe, especially with kids, apparently, that's what they do. They find ways to disguise the repetition. Does that apply to Jeet Kune Do?
I think in the like in Bruce Lee's notes, the three stages of a technique. I think once you feel yourself, then mm-hmm. you feel with the opponent, and then in the third stage is the like in sparring, fighting stage. I think. To be able to learn a technique, you need to do repetition for the muscle memory,
mm-hmm.
The speed, the relaxation. You learn how to feel your body, the body feel. Even just a simple stance, you don't learn that first year even or so, because you need to really feel the on-card position, and to feel that is not only by yourself, but also in a combat. So you
right.
feel the energy of your opponent through your on-card position, because your on-card position is, as the name says, on guard, that you don't need to do anything to get hit. The other person needs to do something. And that is what I said before about the two bubbles.
Right.
Bubble and no man's land is crossed. Then you decide what to do. But always it depends on the footwork and your way of moving, that you can be a step ahead of your opponent. And
okay.
There the stance and the alignment and the footwork create what is the rules of JKD and makes everything coming from the structure, so that you can do certain things, you know how to do certain things, and they come out of you without thinking, just as a reaction. And the opponent needs to circulate, because the on-card position blocks without doing anything the direct attack. Or when it's attacked, you can easily counter-attack.
how do you answer this? If somebody asks you, what's the sparring like in Jeet Kune Do? How do you answer that?
There's two ways, because I think sparring is extremely important in JKD. If you don't spar, you are losing the essence of JKD. Mm-hmm. Because everything that is learned in JKD needs to be applied in a sparring environment. That doesn't mean that you need to knock the head out of opponent, because most of us work on the next day. You need to use the equipment so that you can use different energy levels so that no harm is done. But I start sparring just with shin guards, with footwork, and then go up boxing, kickboxing, and then with MMA gloves, and then we use these reinforced Taekwondo kimonos that you can see in some of our videos, so you can grab the clothing with the MMA gloves where all is out. You can do whatever. And that is an experience that I think everyone needs to experience. And I always ask my students that the question that, have you ever danced with the devil? And that is an experience when you get punched in your head in the ground for the first time, and tapping out doesn't count.
Right.
And there's always two reactions to that. And you can either fight back or you surrender. So I think that reaction is nice to see from the students as well. And I think the sparring is honestly expressing yourself. There's no superficial mask on anyone, because you can't hide yourself. What you are, you need to go to a certain limit in a sparring so that mask, whatever it is taken off, and the true personality comes out. My students, I know I can trust them, because I know how they are in a fighting situation, because we have tried out. So there's no mask, so there's no hiding away. It is what you are. I think that's also the beauty of the sparring, because you are what you are. There's no masks or no one that you can hide behind.
Right. Okay. So you keep saying there's no mask, and you said shin guard, boxing glove or MMA glove, and the kimono, but you didn't say headgear.
Yeah, we had a headgear. Yeah.
Okay. I wasn't sure.
Obviously, it is good to spar sometimes without the headgear, so you know how it feels. Mm-hmm. But for the experience, but usually, because you work on the next day, I think it's good to have a headgear with the bars in front of your nose, so right. You get broken nose, because the straight lead always goes to the nose, so it's a
right. The boxing, fencing, Wing Chun, do you agree or disagree that that's all there is to Jeet Kune Do?
I would say that Wing Chun is a small part. I think because of Bruce Lee's experience on Wing Chun and his Hong Kong roots, his training on Wing Chun, and what he experienced through that, I think there's a little bit of Wing Chun, but he evolved away from that, and there was not really much Wing Chun in the late years of JKD. I think Wing Chun part of JKD is the historical part, which could be some of the trapping. But I think even the philosophy of JKD comes more of the fencing, of the stop hit, stop kick, even though it's a kick, but it's from the fencing. And the structure is much more of the fencing than Wing Chun. Wing Chun structure really doesn't fit into JKD.
So,
and then, the vertical fist comes from, well, it comes through boxing, but from fencing, even though in Wing Chun you had the vertical fist. But right. I think that was just a coincidence.
Ah, okay. Recently it came up that that when he got to Seattle, that Bruce Lee spent some time training in Wing Chun again. Did you hear that story?
Yeah, I heard that. Yeah, I think and he had some training in New York with Hawkins Cheng and all that. And just here where I live, coincidentally, Victor Khan has an apartment as well. Yip Man student. And I've had dinner a few times with him and one of his students. And I think a lot of people want to get credit for having taught Bruce Lee because that is also a sales tool.
Right.
And now as Bruce Lee is not here, it's very difficult to document that.
Yeah. Is the history of Jeet Kune Do in Spain documented?
In which way?
I mean, like, can somebody say Jeet Kune Do came to Spain at this time with this event?
Yeah, I think yes. There's Michael Andalus, who was my instructor, the JKD Concepts from Santo, and his partner from that time, Felipe Mercado. They brought a lot of JKD original students to Spain. They both came from Australia. And then there's the Cinturo Negro black belt owner in Spain, who the editor in Madrid, I don't remember the name now, and Joaquin Marcelo, who were the pioneers of JKD in Spain. But then it kind of just exploded. Everyone, here's like, I think in Europe, maybe after Italy, Spain has the most JKD schools that there is.
Okay, so it's similar then, you would say, to, it starts with a few people and then it spreads, just like it did in the United States. It's, you know, Los Angeles, and then there was a demand in other parts of the country, and then a demand in other parts of the world.
Yeah.
So kind of the same thing.
Yeah, but I think that is through this unfortunate, should I say, like, pyramidical way of doing JKD in the world. Because if you bring a master from USA of JKD to Spain, he has his costs plus the charges, mm-hmm. which means that you need to promote that seminar. That means that you need to bring a lot of students. That means that you want to have a lot of instructors. That means that this is kind of pyramid kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And obviously that makes it grow quite fast. And this commercial way of certificates and this and that. So obviously it needs to grow fast so that it can keep itself growing.
Yeah. Is there a better approach?
I think that's a very personal thing.
Okay.
That is for me, certainly not the way. I rather have the quality and not the quantity.
Right.
When we had the school active in the school installations before, we had this policy that if a new student comes in, he was on a 3-month tryout.
Right.
After which, he also obviously decided if he wanted to continue, but also we voted unanimously. So that if someone was against that person to stay, he would not stay in the club, because if we fight hard, you don't want to have some bad feelings between the people,
yeah.
Because the aim is to learn and not to make harm to anyone, just to pay back some stupid things. So. It's important that everyone is happy and trying to make the warrior next to you become better, because that is the interest of each and in the individual to become better as well.
Let's close it up with this. What was your original driving force to pursue Jeet Kune Do? And has it changed? Is it still the same driving force?
It's the same. I think I see it more clear as the years, months, and days go by. I think more clarity is needed for the JKD world, which is difficult or impossible to do, but at least it's responsibility of each individual to search for the right information, not right. accept everything that is said, and right. everything that is even said by the original students, they right. also can be wrong. There could be different interests. And I think for a responsible JKD student that we all are, even the instructors, I think it is important to search for the truth, not to accept anything just because it's said because so and so.
Right.
I think in JKD, as in any martial art, was the egos as well play a big part. And I think in JKD, we need to totally forget about the egos if we want to learn. And student can't have ego. And every, in my opinion, every single instructor needs to be a student. Mm-hmm. Always have something to learn. You can never master JKD. It's always mastering JKD.
So it's not impossible, it's just really difficult.
Impossible is a small word thrown by small people, like Muhammad Ali said. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Okay. So I have to. This is always my official closing question. What's the best way for somebody to get in touch with you?
There's no best way. Yeah, I don't know. Facebook is easy. My email, jari@jkd.es. But I'm actually happy without too many connections. So.
Okay, good. Okay. You know what's fun? It's fun to pull up your website and then translate it into English.
Yeah, but from Spanish to English, it's okay. But from Finnish to any other language, it's impossible. So it's.
Do you have a training group in Finland?
No, not yet. Not yet. Never know.
There's a plan, huh? Yeah.
There might be a plan, yeah.
All right. Okay, cool. Well, people heard it here first.
Yeah, nothing is impossible, you say.
Okay. All right. Well, listen, it's been a pleasure to meet you and get to talk to you. I appreciate your agreeing to do this.
I think you did a great job, and I think these dialogues is great for people to actually listen and to think about things. And big hand of applause for you, because I think obviously thanks to the new technologies, this is possible to see and to talk and all that. So I think it's good job.
Well, I mean, this was meant to be, because we had zero technology problems between the two of us.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's tough. So this was meant to be. So we'll do it again.
Excellent.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks again. I really appreciate it, man.
Thank you. Okay.
All right. Okay, so that was Jari Nyman, episode number 131 of the Jeet Kune Do Dialogues. So you guys feel free to share, like, comment, ask questions. I'll ask Jari to go through the comments and see if there's anything that he or I need to reply to. Follow me on Twitter at Dwight Woods and on Instagram at Dwight D. Woods. At ilovejeetkunedo.com, the Quick Skills Series Volume 1 is still available. Coming up on the Jeet Kune Do Dialogues next week, June 26th, episode 132, a repeat performance with Jason Carroll of Greenville Academy of Martial Arts. And that should be at the regular 6 p.m. Eastern time, right? So I'll see some of you Wednesday for the Jeet Kune Do broadcast, and the rest of you next Friday for the new episode of Jeet Kune Do Dialogues. Until then, this is Dwight Woods, the Jeet Kune Do Rebel, signing off. I'm off to get sushi. You guys enjoy your weekend, and I'll talk to you soon. Take care.